Revisions to Medicaid policies in Iowa could leave hundreds of thousands at risk.
On December 1st, one of our primary insurers would no longer be in business.
And the changes will affect Dubuquers in just a couple days. That's our top story tonight on LCTV News.
The world of insurance and healthcare can be a difficult maze to navigate.
But for Iowans on Medicaid, it's about to become even more difficult.
For area residential care, the beginning of this month brought with it some of the worst news.
Just about November 1st, we were told on December 1st, one of our primary insurers would no longer be in business.
AmeriHealth, one of the three for-profit insurance companies that covers Iowa, will leave 200,000 people in essence stranded. In our local community, it hits hard.
And what we found in the Dubuque community is that most of our medical providers and therapy providers all signed up with AmeriHealth Caritas.
But who does this affect?
If you think about the traditional Medicaid-funded population, they are people who live in poverty, they are children, and they are medically fragile. They are people who require long-term care.
And just when it couldn't get worse,
in which Amerigroup announced they did not have the capacity to take on 100,000 new clients.
While people like Sue are worried about the future for people in long care facilities, the Department of Human Services doesn't seem too worried.
So in terms of disability services and covered benefits, those would be the same, no matter which MCO they were with. The only difference in benefits between the plans are what are called value-added services, and those are things like, weight loss programs and gym memberships.
Iowans on Medicaid are worried that this transition might not go as smoothly as DHS officials are expecting and could cause a gap in their coverage, or even worse, loss of certain services offered through Medicaid.
Many Medicaid recipients and caretakers won't know the full extent to how this will affect them until the transition takes place this Friday.
Big changes for the business department at Loras are on their way in the near future. Loras College President Jim Collins announced that the Francis J. Noonan School of Business will open in the fall of 2018. Fundraising efforts brought in over $106 million for the new program. Many business students are excited for all the opportunities the new School of Business will bring.
We're going to have a new finance center in a couple of years. They're just totally revamping the business program, Kane Hall. We're going to have third, fourth, and fifth floors all dedicated to the School of Business. And it's just going to lead to a lot of benefits for Loras students and then when they graduate going forward.
Loras is already accepting applications for the School of Business for next fall. Dubuque drivers will have a second roundabout to navigate in 2018. The new single-lane roundabout will be at the intersection of North Grandview and University Avenue. Construction is planned to begin in early June. North Grandview Avenue will remain open to traffic in both directions throughout construction, and access to surrounding businesses will be maintained. A public information meeting will be held at Holy Trinity Lutheran Church's Living Faith Center this Thursday night from 5 to 7.
Elementary students in Dubuque Public Schools now have a chance to improve their bowling game with some new classroom bowling kits.
Kelly Kiboshik is live in the newsroom. Kelly, how did the school district acquire these bowling kits?
The United States Bowling Congress and the Women's Bowling Association donated money for 6 bowling kits. I got to see these kits in use at Sageville Elementary in part 2 of my series, Beyond the Classroom.
First graders at Sageville Elementary have a lot to cheer about. Every time Jocelyn Peacock pulls a strike, she runs to the whiteboard to write down her name.
I get my name up there.
It's about when you get all the pins down, you get to write your name on the strike at the strike. Club.
The strike club is what these 6 and 7-year-olds are bowling for. But their teacher, Mrs. Riley, says otherwise.
They work towards character, good character, focusing on following the rules, respecting each other, self and others, equipment.
By taking turns and cheering each other on,
better luck next time.
These first graders are actively working toward good character skills.
Can you give me the ball, please?
And these new bowling kits were much needed.
The ones that we did have are a little older, outdated, and so needed to be replaced.
Each kit includes weighted pins, a rubber ball, and a carpet lane.
You can do it, Haley.
To Mrs. Riley, there are many reasons her students look forward to bowling.
it's not so competitive. You know, it's all about celebrating what you can do, but also what others can do.
The students at Sageville have one more day of their bowling unit before the bowling kits are rotated to the next school. In the newsroom for LCTV, I'm Kelly Kaboshik.
Thanks, Kelly. The kits are being rotated around the 12 public elementary schools in the Dubuque Community School District.
On Friday, Mindframe Theaters rolled out the red carpet for a special premiere. A group of local filmmakers made their film debut with the premiere of their movie, Black Friday. The movie was shot and created right here in Dubuque and was shown on Black Friday at Mindframe Theaters. After going through the creative process, producer Jamie Schmidt had some words of wisdom for anyone thinking about trying it themselves.
If you really want to make a movie, if you want to do really anything in life, you just pick up a camera and you do it. If I could give anybody advice, it's don't let anybody like put you down. Because essentially, you're going to prove everybody wrong.
Mindframe Theaters is a large proponent for local creators, often premiering their work. Black Friday is one of two movies filmed in Dubuque within the past year, with another film due to premiere in 2018.
The Dubuque Community School District is in the running for a $6 million architectural bid that would be used to add on to the Alta Vista campus. The Alta Vista addition would help combine the programs at the Hillcrest and Four Oaks campuses, moving all the programs to one central location. Originally, the Alta Vista campus was a grade school, but it is currently being used as a high school. With this current design space, it can be a bit tight. While this addition would save residents tax dollars and give students some much-needed room, there is another important reason for the addition.
The addition would house special ed programs for the most part, and so by combining the two programs, we would be able to offer additional services.
While no set date has been stated for the beginning of the additions, the school district has high hopes for the project.
The Avery Foundation is up and running around the tri-states. Its focus is helping those in need of financial assistance while undergoing cancer treatments.
Reporter Caitlin Till is live with more details about the Avery Foundation's mission.
Thanks, Ben. I got a chance to visit with the Avery family earlier this week and learned that although the foundation officially came together just this year, it's an idea that's been brewing since 1981.
Anyone in the tri-states with cancer can apply for grants from the foundation to help with expenses. Then, based off of need, the grants are given out. The more donations, the bigger the grants.
This is our first year, and the grant applications just became available November 1st.
After three fundraising events already under their belts, the Avery Foundation is ready for more.
We were lucky enough to be accepted by the Bill Gates Foundation on Facebook, so anyone that donates to us on Facebook on Giving Tuesday, we will get matching money from the Bill Gates Foundation.
They raised over $3,500 yesterday, and that's without any match from the Bill Gates Foundation. But they haven't always had such great luck.
6 out of 10 of us have had cancer. Julie was diagnosed in June of 1981, passed away in August of 82. Jim was diagnosed in January of 14 and passed away December 15.
Jim was a motorcyclist and he was actually in a stunt show.
It's clear the Averys have learned to live life to the fullest and give what they can to those who have also been affected by cancer, leaving behind a legacy that they hope carries on for years to come.
He always said he led a normal life. The picture shows it. Autographed that to my son before he died.
As you saw, Jim's motto was live a normal life, but the Averys are anything but normal. Yet, they've still developed a way to help others in the community. Reporting for LCTV, I'm Caitlin Till.
Thanks, Caitlin. The Avery Foundation is actually the only foundation of its kind here in the Midwest.
If you're interested in donating or learning more, you can find them on Facebook or go to their website, averyfoundation.org. That's AveryFndtn.org. A local homeless shelter is experiencing difficulties in providing services. Located next to St. John's Evangelical Lutheran Church, the Almost Home Shelter provides services for homeless men. Due to increased need, the shelter expanded its months of operation and its daily schedule to aid the homeless. However, a lack of volunteers means that the organization can't operate effectively. Executive Director Gwen Kirkhoff encourages people in the community to give their time and effort to help those in need.
It makes you feel good. And not only feel good, but I think it opens up your eyes to what is really happening in our neighborhoods, our downtown neighborhoods.
In addition to current services, rooms are being built to accommodate the homeless who are working towards education and employment.
Now it's time for everyone's favorite part of the show, Happy Joe's Trivia. We'll ask you the question, and you can send us your guesses on Twitter at @LCTV_news. Here's the question.
What was the name of the local movie premiered at Mindframe Theater last week? Was it A, Blood Red, B, Black Morning, or C, Black Friday? Send in your guess, and we'll reveal the winner at the end of the show. Don't go away, because when we come back, men's and women's basketball score a pair of wins. We've got the highlights.
And men's cross-country heads to nationals. Could they run with the pack? We've got the answer coming up.
Hey, Travis.
Get some friends, loser.
Bro, you all right, man? Lean on me. Thanks. When you're not strong, and I'll be character. Pass it on. I'll help you carry. A message from the Foundation for a Better Life.
Welcome back. The Loris men's cross country team finished an impressive ninth place at the 2017 NCAA Division III Cross Country Championships on the 18th. This is their highest finish in the school history. Senior Timothy Sevig was 36th overall, earning him an All-American honors. Coming behind him is senior Mason Tope, finishing 40th and making it Tope's third All-American in cross-country history for Loris. Also, senior Bryant Nugent cut 5 seconds from his time at the 2016 NCAA Division III Cross-Country Championships. Looking forward to a 2018 season, Loris will have three of its top seven runners, including Jack Carroll, Preston Cotter, and Patrick Woolock. Back here at Loris, the women's basketball team in a high-scoring game against the Beloit Buccaneers on Saturday. Sophomore Taylor Walker stole the court early, creating the biggest Duhok lead for the first quarter. But the Buccaneers answered back with 11 straight points to pass the Duhawks up 16-14. Duhawks not letting down their guard. For a second, they fired back in the 2 3-pointers from Miranda Chapman. Loris finished their season with a high of 94 points over Beloit and is bringing their record 3-1.
Overall, 3-1 is where we probably should be. We got some real nice tests coming up next 3 games for sure in conference, so we'll see.
The Duhawks will take on Coe College tonight. Coming off their loss against Concordia, Wisconsin, the Duhawks are eager to rack up points against the Ripon Redhawks. The Duhawks take first with the lead from a pass from Ryan DeCano to Cole Navigado, resulting in 2 more points for Loris. Not long after a brief fight back from Ripon, redshirt freshman David Wedewer scores a 3-pointer with yet another assist from DeCano. Josh Ruggles runs a 4-point streak, with a layup bringing the Duhawks back into the lead, 61-60. With a tied score of 88, Jake Tolman takes the game for Loris with 2 pointers, with just 3 seconds left in the game. The men will take on Coe tonight, so if any Duhawks are in the Cedar Rapids area, come be sure to check out the game tonight at 8 p.m. And now we have reporter Maddie Wedlake live from Coe to take a look at tonight's game. Maggie, what are you expecting tonight?
Thanks, Kaylin. As you can see behind me, the women's game has just got underway, with Coe leading the Duhawks by 10. Some key players tonight for the Duhawks include junior Taylor Walker, who is coming off of a career-high performance, tallying 12 points, 4 assists, and 2 steals against Beloit, as well as senior Addie Auberman, who has recorded double-digit points in all 4 games so far this season. The Coe Hawks currently hold a 1-2 record, but don't count out Coe senior Jenna Lehman, who leads Coe's offense, averaging 17 points a game. Switching gears to the men's, some Duhawks to look out for include junior Josh Ruggles, who tallied 37 points in his last game, as well as junior Ryan DeCanio, who is averaging 4.5 assists per game. Coe's player to watch is Spencer Williams, who is averaging 11 points per game. Reporting live for LCTV News, I'm Maggie Wedlake. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Maggie. And finally, back home, the Dubuque Fighting Saints face the Sioux City Musketeers in an intense matchup. Take a look at this. Right out of the gate, key player Adam Tisdale opens the scoreboard with this goal less than a minute into the game. The Musketeers jump back in the first period with 2 goals by Matt Miller and Cole Kepke. Sioux City had the lead for all of the 27 seconds because Tisdale fights back with another goal for the Saints. Adam Tisdale makes one last goal and a hat trick, making it the second of his career and a new record for the Saints.
They were coming out. They came out really fast. Actually, they shocked us a bit. So we had to counter that, and I think we did.
The Musketeers fight back with 2 goals, bringing the final score 5-4 in favor of the Saints. The team plays against on December 1st against the Cedar Rapids Rough Riders at the Mystique Ice Center. And that's all I have for sports shorts. Ben and Bailey, back to you guys.
Thanks, Caitlin. We're taking a quick break, but coming up, a group of local comedians are building the city's underground comedy scene.
And we're highlighting a couple holiday events you won't want to miss this winter. Stick around.
As anchors, we don't always feel like our voice is heard, so we brought somebody in to help us out.
We'll have more highlights coming up
on this edition of Sports Zone.
Hey, Aiden, we're running low on time. We're gonna have to cut your story.
What? Are you serious? Are you kidding me? You're not gonna let these guys finish this? They work on this all week long, and you're telling me?
You know what? Get out of here!
Come on! It may not always go our way, but it's really changing the culture around here.
What in the world?
Since the beginning of this year, an underground entertainment scene in Dubuque has been on the rise, stand-up comedy. I got to know a few local comedians who make up the scene and why they love what they do.
Charming.
It's like turning a switch.
I work at a record shop.
I work at a bar.
I work as a mailman.
By day, it's business as usual. But by night, the only business they care about is funny business. The Dubuque comedy scene has seen nothing but growth since the beginning of this year.
We started about 11 months ago, so in January, and at that time we had about 3 people.
We were working to try and find an open mic spot that we could do every week.
And so, basements like the one here at Monk's Coffee Pub have turned into showrooms for more and more local comedians. Todd Basinger can explain what comedy means to him in one simple word.
Therapy. You got a lot of crappy stuff happening in your life, you gotta talk about it.
For Chris Kaufman, these open mics are the remedy to a condition you might not expect a comedian to have.
Having been agoraphobic for a long time, I wanted some place to kind of have a release.
Those who have agoraphobia feel intense anxiety being in places that might cause embarrassment. But the promise of laughter is enough to keep the comedians and the audience coming back time and time again. A mailman, a record shop worker, and a bartender walk into a coffee pub to be comedians. Because jokes are their passion.
I just want to keep doing it for the rest of my life. It's a great way to stay in shape.
You can catch Todd, Chris, Ryan, and more local comedians at their open mics every Monday at Monk's Coffee Pub and every other Thursday at Tavern on the Main. The shows start at 9 p.m.
It's that time of year again, time to take a stroll through the Christmas lights at Murphy Park. Over the last 23 years, Dubuquers have come to embrace the tradition of driving through the Hillcrest Family Services Reflections in the Park Festival of Lights display. Thanksgiving marked the official opening of the season's display, and it will be open until January 1st. The display is being held between 5 to 10 p.m. every night with a fee of only $10 per car to enter or $8 in advance.
In preparation for the holiday season, the Hotel Julian Dubuque is hosting their annual tree lighting ceremony tonight.
Amber Krieg is there right now. What's going on down there, Amber?
Thanks, guys. The tree lighting tradition has been a ceremony here at the Hotel Julian Dubuque for 6 years now. Here to talk with me a little bit about it today is General Manager Dwight Hophouse. So thanks for joining me today.
Thanks for having me. Thank you for coming
on. All right. So could you just tell me a little bit about this tradition? How did this all get started?
We wanted to create the hotel to be a traditional place for families to come back to Dubuque to enjoy. And we thought the 12 days of Christmas being kind of significant. We decided to create 12 different events for the Dubuque Kingdom officially starting off with Cyber Monday, but the more holiday side of it is the tree lighting beginning tonight.
All right, sounds cool. So now I can see that you have a lot of stuff going on here tonight. It's not just the tree. What else can visitors expect to find if they stop by tonight?
So tonight they can stop by, they'll be able to see here the Loras College Chamber Singers. They're going to be performing. The children will be able to be with Santa and take photographs and get their picture taken and also receive a gift. And then they get to see the official unveiling of the tree.
All right, sounds like you got a lot of good stuff going on here tonight. So I see that this tree is pretty intricate. So how does the decorating process go around here for that?
So the sales team goes out in August and selects a tree from the Anderson Tree Farm, gets brought into the hotel on the Sunday after Thanksgiving, and then 3 days to get set up. So the lights are on Monday, decorations Tuesday, and then the final unveiling and draping will be today.
All right, so thank you so much for joining me today, Dwight. Reporting live from the Hotel Julian Dubuque, I'm Amber Creek. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Amber. That event is going on until 8 o'clock tonight, so be sure to stop down after the show.
And now it's time to reveal the winner of our Happy Joe's Trivia. Congratulations to Logan Schroeder. You're the lucky winner. You can pick up your Happy Joe's in your mailbox later this week.
Thanks so much for tuning in tonight. We'll be back in 1 week with the Holiday Live Show here at LCTV with Sports Zone and News. Thanks for tuning in and have a great night.